Great to be here. My pleasure. I like to guide you a little from even the old transactional system. We decided to go for Unix in 81, 82, before some of you were born even. And we're even pioneering in client server, Boeing 35,000 users on one instance. And my idea was the be-all and end-all is ERP. By the way, the name is even wrong. We call it enterprise, but sorry, we never reached that level. It's maybe entity requirements planning. It's maybe the mother of all complexity, if you look to ERP. Real complicated systems, but then we had more silos. And ERP ever could make supply chain. Then I had a dream, start again, my company, and I was thinking, okay, it became too complicated to have everything in one process in all the silos. And we came to the conclusion you need SOAR, service-oriented architecture, was in the 90s, enterprise service bus, bring everything on the internet, everything in the browser, 98. The browser should be the everything on everything. And you bring the business process in the browser, and you do the composing in the browser. You're not doing longer programming. Aligning IT and business, 98. Too early, 10 years too early. The CIO was afraid for his own shadow, if you look to that market. But okay, it's a lot. We came on that moment already, 2001, to what we say, one version of the truth on the enterprise. If you take all your entities. Because it's what we did. And we moved from transactional oriented, I throw it to your throat, you do what I dictated you. And then you, if you can't follow me, you went to this awful spreadsheets. There we could do case management together. Case driven, case management, and this transactional stuff, and bring it together to one version of the truth. That was my second company, if you look here, what we see in the Cordys world. Going from system of records to system of differentiation. Okay, then I sold this company and we were working already on what we called, hey, we have to go outside the enterprise. Even this could not make supply chain. And then think to blockchain. And where is the value of blockchain? Not in ERP. More downstream. The more the transaction go down, the more the value is there. And it means that the value is going beyond the enterprise. And that's where the value is. And it's not process. Process is too complicated for that. 25% of the people are dealing with processes. 10% are dealing with ERP. 75% are dealing with spreadsheets. And SharePoint and all this awful old stuff. And they do not have one version of the truth. What makes blockchain there? If you have no version of the truth. There is no value, my statement, there's no value in blockchain if you do not have access to the semantic element of the data. And then you're down. We talked this morning over a document, and you do blockchain, but a document is dead like it can be dead. That's a big problem. You need the sensitivity of the data everywhere, every moment. Now, we came to the third layer, and then we called Collabor, and we built what we called a dynamic document. First, I was one of the biggest shareholders in WebEx, and our idea was to do it in a web meeting. And the web meeting could be with my end-to-end process, the gateway for war room. Now, if we go now in the third layer, bring that all together and have a dynamic document, and if I can link that with the blockchain, and what is this dynamic document? It's no longer process-driven, it's simpler. The third layer out of the enterprise is no longer what we called process-driven, it's task-driven. The knowledge worker is only doing the task. And it's simple. 75% of all the processes, but simple. No ERP, no algorithms. It's simple, but it's done by spreadsheets. If we even can inherit in my task everything as an end-to-end process, bring it there, and then try to go further with the blockchain. Now let me go and guide you a little in the direction. We have seen little amiss going from the relation between the blockchain and the software, even legacy software. It means the network leader on the one hand and the community leader. And how to combine these two stuff together. Now, for us, I have now a chance to have one version of the truth in this environment. That means I have now a chance, we had it already this morning, we should not put underwear on blockchain. I have a chance now to give only this meaningful data. And this meaningful data is every status of my workflow. and my documents are dynamic, I can make a whole chain of documents. It's too complicated to do with BPM. BPM is the old world. It's even too complicated to do it in a PaaS platform, beautiful like Salesforce platform as a service, but still old-fashioned transactional driven. But it's beautiful, one instance, everything, beautiful. I was yesterday on Google platform, amazing, if you look to, and what we go, and we go to CaaS, we say in Dutch, container as a service. Could be the blocker. But we bring all those components that are coming as a containerized service in what we call the consumerized IT. If we can unite that with this world, then we can do great stuff. Now, doing this one, say, okay, we like to say, okay, bring this. First, for me, what is blockchain is the proof of reality. If the other element is there, then the proof of reality can be so thin every time. And if I can control this, and if we talk here with these networks, this dual type of stuff, then we can come to totally new stuff. Bring it there. First, in my career, I work from here. This old, old-fashioned stuff. And people talk over cloud as nonsense. That is totally nonsense. If you ask Larry Ellison talking over cloud, he was blaming tremendous. He's now talking we are on cloud. It's nonsense. It's only say, some elements are on cloud, but 90%, 80% of the source code is built even before you guys are born. And they're still there, this garbage. Like SAP, 120,000 parameters to even define a system, 80,000 database tables. That's nice for the consultants to what we say at your service. But we say, how can I milk you? It's the old stuff, milking the cow. Will be hard to integrate this old stuff. Here, there's two elements. You can go here with a BPM layer. You go here, what we call the internet of business. Maybe the internet of entities. Everything in a browser. Could be some old stuff. Could be maybe nice if you do it in this PaaS platform. But here, where is the semantic data? Not here. Not always. Sometimes if you can make this one, yes. If you can make an end-to-end process, you can come here. But there's another world. We have the internet of entities, or call it the internet of processes. We are now living in the internet of things. Hundreds of billions of things are talking to us. And who is winning? Is it the sensor, or is it your common sense? Is it common sensor or common sense? I'm voting for common sense. And I like to guide you to the internet of people. The third layer where I see the blockchain layer. United with all these layers means here we need the big data elements. The internet of things, the internet of people. If you take this one together, okay, then, and even use maybe this type of nice stuff on top of this, because this is nice, but becoming a little expensive how cheap this is in this kind of combinations. Combine this and take everything at least on this, but not everything, and be agnostic. Take care that you're agnostic to everyone, agnostic to every blockchain opportunity, but also agnostic to every PaaS opportunity. I know what it is to milk you and to make you dependent on my Baan system, the most dangerous stuff you can have. Use the minimum of platforms, reduce all the bespoke, and focus on open source elements. But why not using all those smart stuff around us? I was again amazed if you see now in 1 year, all those container services are now fully integrated in cars. 7 products who have on their individual 1 billion of users. They're all united already in one container as a service platform. But those guys have no clue from the workflow and how the workflow is dealing. That is where we guys can make a difference and make nice stuff. Now I see it here and say then, okay, what we do here, we collaborate, we do the workflow. In this platform, we built a e-invoicing system, could be maybe a new banking system. I mean, the whole semantic stuff of the e-voice used by a verbinding, I had intellectual property for this stuff, where we do all the semantic stuff for the e-invoice, maybe the most important process outside the enterprise. Why not doing that with blockchain? We could have our own banking system that we need no credit cards. And what about identification? Why should we need cards? This should be enough. Google knows exactly how I'm swiping, where I was, how I'm talking, how I'm sitting in my car. But how can we combine those type of stuff? Now, I'd like to bring you a solution where I offer to the informateur and offer to the whole elements to change our country a little in this new way of technology. And what is it? Now, first, my conclusion is, if we can do this stuff here, one second. Now, how to take these three layers? We have them. My old Baan system has still thousands of customers. And they are satisfied still with this old stuff. I cannot say goodbye. Infor is still milking them. They like it very much. How to take these three layers? I mean, if you do everything here, it's 1,000 times more complicated than do it here. Don't use do it here. And there is no meaning here. The more late binding, the more downstream, the more value. For this contract tomorrow, I like to explain to no one what's going on. But my balls and nuts, who cares? The real value for a blockchain is the latest is possible in the chains. And it's even in the supply chain. Till here, till the second layer, everything is inbound, the inbound manufacturing, the inbound company. We have to go to the real outbound world. Now, what I can do here now, with these dynamic documents, even I have not to do BPM and all the stuff here, even I can take an old many documents together, unite them, and collaborate them, and even go the whole document chain. There's 100 times more simple way. Instead of bring all this stuff here and look to a nice project, we call it Spear by Defensium. The cost was only $1 billion for customizing. I mean, in this world, forget blockchain. Bring blockchain, in my opinion, the most ideal position for blockchain is in the task of my workflow. And to enrich that with the Internet of Things, the Internet of Big Data, and all the other elements. And there is where it makes value. You're not talking over an ERP algorithm. It's simple. Do you need two pieces or one? One color? And store only, no garbage, store only maybe one bit of the secure part. Now, and doing this can make it by far simpler. Now, and I came to the conclusion that we see here now more. Instead of this type of world, we came to the conclusion, let's suppose, even for the Dutch government, you know how stupid it is what we're doing. We have 400 municipalities, and we store 400 times our personal data. Now, let's change that. Tomorrow, I ask the informateur to change that. And okay, let's build it in overnight, and we make one web service. We call it the private cloud, because we don't trust the Americans. That's the only private cloud we need. It's simple. We only have this cloud with only our name, address, phone, plus our birth certificate, once. We take KPN, we take NATO top security, and there we need the best identification, the best of the world. And only one simple record. And those stuff, and then blockchain can make a tremendous difference from all the transactions all the time. And that's stored, that is only stored once. It's never stored here. No reason to store it anywhere. I can move 10 times a day. And from there, I can deal with Google, but I can deal with Google with nicknames. I can deal with everything. My neighbor, who is controlling my is by the blessing dienst, controlling my tax dossier, is not knowing that it's me. When my patient dossier is on the street, no one knows it's me. The blockchain can make a change. From this element, and then even from this banking system. Now, and here we say, okay, what are we then doing at our round of top blockchain, etc.? I like to see machine learning. Amazing what we're now doing already. It's embedded in this type of Google stuff. We did it already 20 years ago with neural networks. And we have to do a lot. It's now available. If you can use all your banking transactions, and with this machine learning, we know who is going bankrupt over 3 months, knowing what time is paid, where is all this stuff. This is where the value for the bank is. Not in the banking system. And if you have still then your personal data isolated, that means that's what I like to see here, and everything with big data is around me. Oh, what did we do here? Okay, you did it. Okay. Oh, no. Good. Now, let me come to a conclusion then. if we store once our data, we even then with blockchain, we can see the whole traceability. This is what is going on in Estonia already in the old world. Who is touching me? Why? What circumstances? We can go here to cybersecurity. We take the identification only once, and then we go here with this blockchain and all these elements, maybe this banking system, and then I like to see it only as making hash and making new hash and a new hash and follow the chain. A stamp, that's where I'm going, a verified blockchain. Bringing there in a nice world where, guys, you're living in an interesting world, but we need what we call in Dutch the bindweefsel between the layers. There is the value. It's more task-driven. Don't do too much techie talk. Make it simple. Combine, and then you see all kind of combinations, because for me, it's integrated in the world of big data. It's in the world of Internet of Things. The sensors is everywhere. And then we see totally new services where we never have dreamed of before. Good luck. Looking forward.
Okay. Thank you, Jan. We have some time for a question.
Jan, thanks for your presentation. Don't you think that citizens' data in a private governance cloud is subject then to the life cycle of the politic environment of that specific government? And what will that mean? Because this is quite different from self-sovereign identity, for example.
First of all, it should be controlled by the government. It should be a government cloud. Maybe with some trusted parties around us, and the government, for me, as launching customer, totally control this, and then it could be executed by local ones therein. Now, anyway, Google is not afraid, because there's no money in. It's only some very, very limited stuff. Only the sensitivity of the data is controlled. And then everything can be thousand times simpler, because I can be reached by every minute, everywhere. Now, and look what it saves billions for the government. Doing this stuff, the privacy element is solved. You never have to store data. There is no value in, because big data is millions times more storage than only this limited stuff. That means for those professional ones, it's nothing in. And we could have NATO top security and everything around us. They're already there. No, and I'm now dealing with four or five trusted parties, talking with the government over this type of concepts, bring them together. And see, no, but there is, I'm so sure there is the value, because what we're doing, all this data is stored many times, and once a day we bring it together, and all the logic is stored again, and then all the data and no new logic allowed the data is stored again and again and again. No. This, and there is where these elements like a blockchain make real sense, even with a payment system.
Maybe we can take this, because there is an ethical discussion behind it. We can take that offline,
okay.
Because actually it introduces again a central authority rather than the distributed authority that the blockchain promises as well.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Jan. I think one thing we learned is that our economy thrives on complexity, on distrust. So I hope blockchain will make its promise a reality, that we can organize trust without increasing complexity.